Let me ask you on this Christmas Eve, what is the one thing that your heart is crying for Christmas? Tell you what I want. I want one of those remote control helicopters. Have you seen those things? They're called air hogs. They didn't make that kind of stuff when I was a kid, and all those about my age or a little younger, be a great place right there to say amen. Man, they just didn't make cool stuff, did they? Like they do now. I think if one of my grandsons gets one of those for Christmas, I think I'm going to trade him out of it. I'm gonna find something that he likes, and I'm going to get one of those things. But no, in all seriousness, as I look around today, I would say that if God were to say to me, Craig, now you can have one gift, just one, but if you will ask me for this one gift, I will grant it to whomever you would like that gift to be given to. I think that more than anything else, I would say, Lord, what I would love to have and I would love to see around the world this time of the year is peace. God, more than anything else, I want peace. Because everywhere you look, all of the surroundings, there is such an evidence of a lack of peace. That really is the cry of my heart. I want God to grant peace, peace between the nations. I would pray that God would just eradicate ISIS and remove radical Islam from our world, whose heart beats with war and death and terror that has turned our world upside down and put it in such an uproar. I long for God to give us that peace. I long that God would give us a peace not only between the nations, but a peace between the races. You know, when President Barack Obama was elected as our president, there was one hope that I had. And my hope was that, you know, maybe our first African-American president can take the two races and bring them together to be more peaceful than they've ever been. And yet, the truth is, there is more racism today than there was 25 years ago. And it grieves my heart. I pray that God would grant us peace between the nations and between the races, and that God would grant us peace between the police and between the public. And yet it seems like today that every time those that put on the uniform and they protect and they serve, they go out in great danger as they're being shot in the streets like animals. Pray that God would give us peace in our families and He would give us peace in our churches. And there would just be this overwhelming sense of peace that would envelop us. Wouldn't that be a great place to live if that kind of peace was evident? You know, that's one reason why I love this time of the year. Obviously, it's because Jesus is the center of it. But the one thing that we focus on and highlight at this time of the year is peace. Because the one that we celebrate and the one that we worship, He is the one who came in order that He might bring peace. You know, the one who is worshiped and celebrated, that's synonymous with His name, peace. Isaiah the prophet said, "You shall call Him Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, and the what? The Prince of Peace." In Luke's Gospel, chapter number 2, verses 13 and 14, the Bible says, "And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men." And friend, that's what the Bible says, and yet that is not what we see that is happening all around us. The great American poet Henry Wadsworth Longfellow lost a son in the Civil War, and through that experience of losing a son, he wrote a poem, and the title of that poem was Christmas Bells. It was later put to music, and it was sung. We don't hear it sung very much anymore, and I think I know why. It is because some of the verses in that poem, that carol that we now sing, just seem to be so radically different from the experience that we have. A couple of those verses, and I'll read another one a little later, said, "I heard the bells on Christmas Day, their old familiar carols play, and wild and sweet the words repeat of peace on earth, goodwill to men. And in despair I bowed my head, there is no peace on earth, I said, for hate is strong and mocks the song of peace on earth, goodwill to men." Maybe that's why we don't sing that song much anymore. And it's because that hate, which is so prevalent in our culture, mocks the very song. Now, the question that I ask is, were these angels wrong? Was the Bible wrong? And the answer is no, 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 the angels weren't wrong. And no, the Bible was not wrong. Friend, the reason there is no peace in this world is by and large men have rejected God's peace treaty, which is in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, there will never be any peace on earth between people and people until there is peace on earth between God and men. And it was the Lord Jesus Christ who came to do away with the war between God and men by dying on the cross and being raised from the dead. He paid the debt for our sin. You know, we could say that peace is a bridge, and the two rails that run along that bridge are truth and righteousness. And there can be no peace apart from truth and righteousness. And there can be no truth and righteousness apart from the Lord Jesus Christ. So Jesus did come to bring peace on earth, but primarily that was peace between God and men. And the result of that would be peace between man and man. Friend, God does give peace. God gives peace to us. He gives us a peace from our past. One of the reasons that so many people today do not have any peace is because they are hounded by the guilt of the past. I can tell you from personal experience that I was so hounded by guilt from a sinful past until I put my faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. And then I came to understand that my past, as far as God is concerned, it doesn't exist anymore. My past is buried at the bottom of the ocean. It's cast as far away as east is from the west. I love it that when God looks at us today, when we put our faith in Christ, God doesn't see our past. He sees a present and He sees a future, but there is no past. And that is such good news, to have peace from our past. But God also gives us a peace in our present. See, the kind of peace that I'm talking about is a supernatural peace that is not controlled by the non-peaceful situations and surroundings. No, it's not controlled by that at all, because it's supernatural peace. I read a story, a true story, about two men, two painters, and they were involved in a contest. And the contest was, whoever paints the best portrait of peace will win the award, and it was like $10,000, whoever won it. So this first painter, he painted this beautiful painting, and it was a painting of a beautiful sunset. That was, the sun was setting over a calm sea, and it was a very tranquil-looking picture, and it brought peace to people's hearts as they looked at that, and a calmness. But then the second painter, his painting was quite interesting, and that's the one that won. He painted a picture of a storm. The sky was dark and black, and the thunder was rolling in, and there was lightning flashing in the sky. It was a very chaotic-looking picture. The waves were crashing against the rocks, and there were two stones in that picture. And between those two stones, there was a bird. And the bird was just chirping and singing away. And the title of the picture was, "That's Peace." Friend, that's peace. It's not the absence of bad things. It's not the absence of conflict around us. It's not the absence of war. It's not the absence of terror. But true peace is, listen, a tranquility and a calmness that God gives in the midst of the storm. See, that's real peace. That's true peace. And only God can give that kind of peace. And did you know what the good news is? When you and I put our faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ and our past is gone, that the only possible way that we can live without any peace is to allow that to come into our lives which initially started the war, and that is sin. Sin is that which robs us of our peace and loads us down with our guilt. And until we confess that we've allowed to come back into our lives, that there will be no peace, because there will be guilt, extreme guilt. I read about a brother and a sister, Jack and Sally. Jack and Sally went to visit Grandma and Grandpa for a weekend. And Grandpa had made Jack and Sally two slingshots. And he took them out in the backyard and he taught them to use those slingshots. And he said, "Now I've got to go back in the house for a few moments, but I want you to be careful with these. And don't shoot anything with your slingshot." Well, little Jack, he put a rock in that slingshot. And accidentally, when he pulled it back, accidentally let it go. And it hit Grandpa, one of Grandpa's ducks, in the head and killed it. Sally looked at Jack and Sally said, "I'm going to tell." He said, "Oh, no, please don't tell." "Oh, yes, I'm going to tell Grandma. I'm going to tell Grandpa." "No, please, please don't tell on me," because he knew the trouble he would get into. So when they went back into the house, Grandma told Sally, "We're going to clean house. We've got some dishes to take care of and some dusting and vacuuming." And with a sly look, Sally looked over at Jack. He said, "Oh, Grandma, you know how much that Jack just loves to wash the dishes? And oh, let me tell you about his dusting skills. There is no one who can dust any better than he can. Let me tell you about his vacuuming. He'll get out of bed and beg Mama if she'll let him just do the vacuuming." Oh, Jack said, "Yeah, that's right." All the while, he just burning up inside, you know. Well, later on that day, Grandpa came by and said, "Jack, I need to talk to you for a moment." I said, "Jack, you need to understand this. I know you killed the duck, but I was just waiting to see how long it was going to take for you living as a slave to your sister before you would just tell me the truth and admit it. If you would have just come to me and admitted it, listen, you never would have experienced any of this." Friend, what I'm trying to say is God knows you killed the duck. He knows it. But as long as you just sit on that and you don't talk to God about it, there's no way that you can have any peace in your heart. Peace comes as the result of the confession of our sin to the Lord. And He is just waiting to forgive when we come to Him and talk to Him about it. See, God gives us peace from our past, peace in our present, and God gives us peace for the future. For the future. I really don't know if you and I in our lifetime will ever see peace on earth and goodwill toward men. But I tell you, one day we will. Oh yeah, one day we will. For those of us who have been saved by the grace of God, one day we're going to move into God's house. And God's house is a house of peace. And at that time, God is going to establish the absolute perfect peace forever and ever. And you and I are going to dwell there. You know, those two verses that I read from that poem, they were quite sad. But I want to tell you, the angels were not wrong, they were right. God's word is not wrong, it is right. Because there's another verse in that poem that says, "Then pealed the bells more loud and deep. God is not dead, nor doth he sleep. The wrong shall fail, but the right prevail. With peace on earth, goodwill toward men." It's a done deal. It's going to happen. May you have a peaceful Merry Christmas.